You are watching DHTV, the television program service of California State University, Dominguez Hills.
And instructor. Today is our last broadcast of the semester, but we will be back next fall. And today we're going to look at a nice focus on bromeliads. But before we do that, I like to have a mystery plant. Now this shouldn't be too big a mystery. Let's pull it over here. It's kind of a big one. It's in a 1 gallon pot, but it's gotten awfully tall. So hopefully I can show this to you. I'm going to tilt it down like this and show you the bloom, because the bloom is what it's all about on these. And maybe we could focus in. I don't know how we want to focus in on these, so I spill water all over my pants. But this is our mystery plant. These are native, the genus is native to every continent in the United States. I mean, every continent in the world. Now, this got a little beat up this morning when I was loading it up to bring it down. Some of the flowers got knocked off. But that's a cluster of blooms that come in the spring. And the leaves, these leaves are kind of a little screwed up. We'll talk about that too. There are some special requirements for this genus. And one of them is that it grows in acid soil in order to get adequate iron, or they'll turn yellow on you. So take a look at that. If you think you know the genus for this, give us a call. They're real pretty. They're real showy in the spring. They typically bloom just once in the spring. And they don't repeat bloom throughout the year. You may get some sporadic bloom in the fall, but you're not going to get that pop and that really spectacular bloom that you get in the spring from that genus. So that's our mystery genus. And I actually have some of the flowers here. I'll give you a clue. These flowers are from a different group within the genus as that one we looked at, but look at these flowers. Let's go to the overhead because I just want to show you these flowers so you can get an idea of what our mystery plant is today. And they're falling apart. But if we can go to the overhead, we'll take a look at some of these flowers. Here's an individual bloom that's off of that particular plant. And these here are off a different plant in my front yard that's actually in the same genus, so you can see the flowers are very, very similar, basically identical in form, not, of course, in color or size. But so we actually do grow this genus, but we don't grow typically this plant that I've got. I have a handful of them, and they're not the easiest to grow in Southern California, but they're really interesting. So that's our mystery plant of the day, and I'll go ahead and put these back in the water to keep these flowers fresh, because if someone calls in and takes a guess, then we can talk about this plant in greater depth, and hopefully some will call in. Our number is 1-800-339-1193. Give us a call. This is the live broadcast that you can call in and ask questions about your garden. I'm a plant pathologist and a certified arborist and a licensed agricultural pest control advisor with the state of California. So I should be able to answer your questions about your garden. Whether you have a problem plant or a problem insect or a problem pest, give us a call, 1-800-339-1193, and let's talk about your garden. Now, I've often talked about epiphyllums. Epiphyllums are the orchid cactus, and often they're not blooming when I'm teaching the class. They tend to start blooming right about now and bloom through the summer. And then often when I start my class, start the class back up in September, they're not blooming anymore. But luckily, this particular one that I had, and I'm just gonna try and show you this bloom clearly. This is epiphyllum, and there are many, many hybrids of epiphyllum. It's the orchid cactus. And you can see how spectacular the bloom is. This one is a fluorescent yellow. It opened yesterday morning. They're still open today. But tomorrow they'll probably start to wilt and fade away. They're not long-lived blooms, but on a big plant you can get a lot of blooms, and they'll open up over several weeks, and you can get color several weeks. They do really well in baskets. Let's see which one. Here's this one. You can see how pretty they are. They're really spectacular. And of course, epiphyllums come in a lot of different colors. This is, of course, yellow with kind of a white center. But they come in pinks and reds and whites. So they're really, really pretty. Some of the whites that I have at home are much smaller blooms and not quite so many petals, but really, really pretty. Very easy to grow. It is a cactus. They actually come from cliffs. They grow on cliffs often in areas where they get periodically a lot of rain, but then a long dry period. So they are very drought tolerant. As most cactus are, or really all cactus are. So you only have to water these periodically, maybe once a month in the spring and the fall, a couple times a month in the summer. But these do like a little more water than some other cactus, so you do need to water them, not ignore them completely, if you want to get good blooms and good growth. They're very easy to grow from cuttings. You just cut a leaf off, let the cut end dry for maybe a few days, up to a week, and then stick it in a pot with a nice coarse mix, a cactus mix, or in fact, if you want to use a cactus mix, I would actually cut that about 50% with perlite or vermiculite or something to make it drain even better, because the cactus mixes are a little on the heavy side, according to some of my colleagues at the Huntington Botanical Garden, who say it's too heavy for them. So they don't use cactus. Of course, they make their own mixes up. Now, today we're going to talk about bromeliads. And bromeliads are a great group of plant materials, really quite easy to grow, do quite well in Southern California, and really the whole state. They are tender. Most of them will freeze. Let's talk about the group as a family. The Bromeliaceae, or Bromeliaceae, is the family for bromeliads. They are monocots, which means they are related to the grasses and the palm trees and things like that. Those are all monocots. There are around 3,170 species, native mainly to tropical Americas. Includes both epiphytes, such as Spanish moss, and here we have Spanish moss. This is a Tillandsia, and Tillandsia is a genus within the bromeliad family, and there are many different species of Tillandsia, but this is the smallest of all the bromeliads. It's native from the southern United, from Florida all the way across the south, and it hangs off of trees. You can take just a little tiny piece of this and it will continue to grow. All you have to do is get it wet periodically. Once a day would be excellent, but if you water it every two or three times a week, it'll still do okay. It does better if it gets regular spritzing on a daily basis. So this is Spanish moss, and of course that's Tillandsia eusnioides. And there are terrestrial species of bromeliads, such as the pineapple. Ananus cosmosus is the pineapple, and the pineapple is a member of the bromeliad family. Many bromeliads are able to survive or store water in a tank. And let's just take a look at this Varizia. Now, Varizias are one of the genera within the family. And if we take a look from the top, this will show you what we call the tank or the cup. Now, this is the plant tag. But here is where you can fill it up with water. And if you just keep water in here, the plant will do pretty good. It doesn't really need soil, and it doesn't really need a pot. In fact, you can tie most bromeliads right on to a piece of wood or a trunk of a tree. And if you just keep the cups watered, then they'll do quite well. And you can use a little bit of fertilizer in your water, not very much. They don't need a lot of feeding, and you have to be careful not to burn. The other thing you might want to do periodically is dump out that cup. You don't want that cup to go stagnant. You want that to be fresh water. So periodically, maybe once a week at the most, or a couple times a month, you can tip these over, pour the water out completely, maybe let it sit with no water in it for the rest of the day, and then the next day or at the end of the day, you can fill it back up with water. But you don't want that cup water to go anaerobic or become stagnant or stale in a way. You can also get a mosquito larva in there, and there's often pictures, if you go on the internet, you can find pictures of frogs that live in these bromeliads in the tropics, which is interesting. Now, if you want to see the flower that these varizias have, I don't know if you can see the tag, but they come up, they're kind of flat, and they're often brightly colored in pinks and yellows and oranges. And so varizias are really fun to grow, and they're probably more tender than some of the other genera. But here you can see what the flower looks like, and this says, medium light, a moderately moist soil, average home temperature 55 to 80 degrees. Now they are tender, so if you live in an area where you get a lot of frost, if you're up in the mountains or in the foothills, if you're in Altadena or Sierra Madre or someplace where you get a lot of frost, you need to protect these during the winter months. Bring them onto a front porch, or they do really well on windowsills or in kitchen windowsills. They don't need direct sun. If you have direct sun in the late afternoon, you'll burn your bromeliads. So they can't take that blazing hot afternoon sun, especially in the hot inland valleys. Many bromeliads have that tank. Now, if we bring up our first picture, the red bromeliad, this is just a red bromeliad. I'm not sure what genus this is, but just to show you some of the color, and they can be very, very small plants or very, very large plants. So bromeliads is a big group. The gray-leaved epiphytic tillandsia species that gather water only from the leaf structures called trichomes. And so we'll look a little bit more at tillandsias in a minute. And tillandsias really don't have any roots at all. They depend on being misted and watered on a daily basis. A large number are desert-dwelling succulents, which is hard to believe, but they are. The largest bromeliad is Puya, is a Puya species. Puya is the genus. Reaches 3 to 4 meters tall. That would be about 12 feet tall, in vegetative growth with a flower spike 9 to 10 meters tall. 10 meters, that'd be a 30-foot tall flower spike, and the smallest is Spanish moss. And we actually have a picture of, I thought I had a picture of Spanish moss, but I guess I'm missing that. But we just looked at Spanish moss. So let's continue on here. And the West, the greatest number of species reside in the Andean highlands of South America, which suggests that they actually originated there in an evolutionary sense. The West African species, Pithecanaria feliciana, is the only bromeliad not endemic to the Americas. So bromeliads are really an American species or a New World plant. They're not really known from Africa or Europe. This species is thought to have, they have thought to have reached Africa via long distance dispersal about 12 million years ago. This one particular species that occurs in West Africa got there 12 million years ago. Humans have been using bromeliads for thousands of years. The Incas, Aztecs, and Maya, and others used them for food. They used them for protection, fiber, and ceremonially in many of their ceremonies. European interests began when Spanish conquistadors returned with pineapple, which became so popular as an exotic food that the image of the pineapple was adapted into Europe in art and sculpture. And let's take a look at number 4, the pineapple, and you can actually see. Now, it takes about 2 years for a pineapple to actually, this is actually the flower spike. Bring this up full screen. This is the flower spike, or the inflorescence. So this is the fruit here. You can cut this off, and this part will start growing again. But here's the plant in the background, and the cup is down here, down there. So pineapple is a bromeliad. And, of course, pineapples are grown mostly in tropical regions. In 1776, the species Guzmania lingulata was introduced to Europe, and this caused a sensation among gardeners who were unfamiliar with this plant. And we can take a look at photo number 5, which is Guzmania lingulata, and bring that up full screen, because these Guzmanias, this is a very typical flower for that genus, Guzmania. And these spikes are usually, you can't see it, you're looking straight down on it, but usually the spikes are quite tall. Now, there's an interesting aspect of bromeliads, and one of that is that they are mostly hummingbird pollinated. That may not be true for every species in the family, or every genus in every species, but it may very well be. I'm not exactly sure if they're all hummingbird pollinated, but mostly they're hummingbird pollinated. And so the hummingbirds are attracted to the color red. And if you have a tall flower, that whole flower will be bright red or a bright color. If you don't have a tall inflorescence, if the inflorescence is down deep in the cup or in the center of the plant, then the leaves that surround it will turn red. And we'll see that in some upcoming photographs. In 1828, Acmea fasciata was brought to Europe, followed by Varisia splendens in 1840. These transplants were successful enough that they are still among the most widely grown bromeliad varieties in the trade. And let's see, let's go with number six, which is Acmea fasciata, and bring that up full screen. Now, most of you have probably seen this for sale in supermarkets or in nurseries. Very, very popular plant. It's often referred to as silver vase or the urn plant. It's native to Brazil. Probably the best known species in the genus, and it is often used like a house plant. So you can see each individual bloom. Now, if you notice, this is a tall spike, and the leaves have not turned. It's not doing what I want it to do here. Here, let me see if I can get it to do it. There we go. The leaves themselves have not changed color. That's because this spike is so tall that they don't change color. So the plant, this particular species grows fairly slowly, reaching to between 1 and 3 feet in height. In a pot, it won't get that big. In the ground, it might. And spreading up to 2 feet. It has elliptic, oval-shaped leaves that are between 18 and 36 inches long and are arranged in a basal rosette. Now, almost all bromeliads are really arranged in a basal rosette. Fasciata, or the silver vase or urn plant, requires partial shade and a well-drained but moisture-retentive soil. It can also be grown epiphytically, as, for example, with moss around its roots and wired to rough bark. There aren't too many serious pests to the plant, and I've been told by some of the nurserymen who grow bromeliads, they have no pests. Well, I don't believe that, but they have very few pests. But some people will tell you they have none. Well, they have none until you suddenly have some. So now root rot can be a problem if the soil is kept too wet. Now you've heard me talk about root rot, and there are some very specific causes of root rot, like the oak root rot fungus, which is Armillaria mellea, which occurs throughout California and North America. And there's also Phytophthora root rot, and Phytophthora is a water mold. Phytophthora has about 100 species of Phytophthora, that's a genus. And some of the most famous, Phytophthora infestans causes late blight of potato, which is not a root rot. But it also, there's Phytophthora cinnamomi, which causes root rot on thousands of different hosts. But in this case, I think if you keep these things soaking wet, if you keep that your soil wet with these bromeliads, it may be that the soil goes anaerobic, and that's what kills the roots. I'm not sure they're susceptible to Phytophthora, but Armillaria has a big host range, so potentially you might be able to get some. Now, scale insects and mosquitoes will sometimes breed in the pools of the water that are trapped between the leaves. So if you keep bromeliads, it is a good idea not only just to keep that water in the cup fresh, but to dump out any mosquito larvae that may be reproducing in them. In the 1800s, breeders in Belgium, France, and Netherlands started hybridizing plants for the wholesale trade. And since then, there are literally probably tens of thousands of hybridized bromeliads. So you can see all sorts of different hybrids. Many exotic varieties were produced up until World War I, which halted breeding programs and led to the loss of some species. Now, they became very popular again after World War II. Since then, Dutch, Belgium, and North American nurseries have largely expanded bromeliad production dramatically. As you can attest, you go into any grocery store, go into Osh, go into Vons, or any of these places, and you'll see bromeliads for sale in every one of them. And they're very popular because you can bring them inside, and the flowers last for months, and they need very little care. And then they're going to grow new plants, and so once you buy it, you've got it. It will grow new plants quite easily. Bromeliads are a varied group of organisms. They're adapted to many climates. The foliage usually grows as a rosette. It's the most widely planted and colored of any plant in the world. Leaf colors range from maroon through shades of green to gold. There are varieties that have leaves with red, yellow, white, and cream variegations. Others may be spotted with purple, red, or cream, while others have different colors on tops and bottoms of the leaves. The inflorescences produced by bromeliads are also regarded as considerably more diverse than any other plant family. Some flower spikes may reach 10 meters tall, while others measure only 2 to 3 millimeters across, so some are very, very small. Upright stalks may be branched or simple, with spikes retaining their color for 2 weeks up to 12 months, depending on species. Now let's take a look at this one, and I'll talk a little bit about it. And it's filled with water. Now this is one that I purchased a while back. I'm going to just shove it over here. And if you want to come in, now this flower has looked like this for a long time. The plant's looking a little sad. And this is from Kent Bromeliads. Now Kent Bromeliads is one of the most one of the biggest growers of bromeliads in the United States, and certainly the biggest in the United States, or on the West Coast, probably the biggest in the United States. And I'm trying to figure out exactly which genus this is. And I thought it was going to be Bilbergia, but I think I'm wrong. This is not Bilbergia. And this is one of the problems when you lose a plant tag. I have the tag here, but I'm surprised it doesn't tell me the genus. And I may try and figure it out. But anyways, I wanted to show you, you know, this has been blooming for probably 3 months. Now, if we take a look at the plant itself, I had this out on my front porch on some of the very cold nights we had back in January and February. And if you take a look here, this is frost damage because they are tender. But what's going to happen is this is going to throw up a pup or a new plant off the base, and it's already starting to, ouch. But if we look right here, you can see the frost damage that occurred to this. This is frost damage. So the plant got a little beat up because I left it outdoors in the winter months. The flower seems to have done pretty good, even though the plant itself got a little frosted. Now, if we lift up these leaves and spin this around, and I don't know if you can see it, but if we can we come down a little bit? And right here is a new plant coming up right here. See that? That's a little pup that's starting up. There's another one right here that's getting a little bigger. See that? So this is going to have several new plants. In fact, there's an even bigger one on this side. Let's look up this one. Look at this right here. Now, these need to get a little bigger before you cut them off. But when they get a little bigger, they're very easily removed and potted up, and they grow really well. So now, again, I'm sorry, I don't know the genus on that. But here's another one that a colleague gave me, and I don't recall the genus again. But and I'm going to try and figure it out before the end of the show. And you can see, now, here's a funny thing. This is not growing in soil. This has no soil at all. So I just keep it in this pot, and I just keep water in the cup, and it flowered beautifully for me. So I do want to pot this up. I've been meaning to. And if you know the name of this, please give me a call, because I've lost the name, or whoever gave it to me and told me the name, I didn't write it down. And I probably could take it down to one of my one of the nurseries I work with on a regular basis and ask them what it is, and they would recognize it right away. One of the better nurseries for Southern California, of course, is the Rainforest Flora and Botanical Garden in Torrance, and that is Paul Isley's nursery, and he grows a lot of bromeliads and a lot of tillandsias. He's one of the biggest tillandsia growers around. In fact, he's been growing tillandsias for a long time. He started growing tillandsias. He's probably one of the first people to grow tillandsias commercially. And I have his book, and I'll show it to you in a minute. But let's talk about some other things about bromeliads. Let's see. Some bromeliads are faintly scented, while others are heavily perfumed. I have personally not noticed the scent from the blooms. I guess I need to check it as they flower in the future. Blooms from the species Tillandsia cyanea resemble and smell of clove. So that would be nice. Let's see. And I have a picture of that. I think number 8 is Tillandsia cyanea. And if we bring that up full screen, you can see Now this is a tillandsia, and this is a very, also I was mentioning the flowers on the varizia, and I'm gonna pronounce that wrong if I don't check it. Yeah, varizia. Look just like this too, and you can see there's a little bloom right there. I don't know if you can notice it, but that what happens is it flowers here and then here, and it keeps going back and forth, back and forth, and the flowers come out of these little bracts like this, this little tiny, often blue or purple. So real pretty, and if we look at number seven, it's a different one, and here's the bloom right there, and they come off on the side, and they continue blooming like this for a good month or two, maybe several. So real, real pretty. And now let's take a look at number nine, if we've got that, because I want to look at Bilbergia, pyramidalis. Oh, here we go. Bring this up full screen. This is Bilbergia. And I believe those other two are Bilbergias. But, I have some of this at home, actually, but it's not blooming, so I didn't bring it in. Really spectacular bloom. Just something else. Now, each one of these is an individual flower, and this whole thing is an inflorescence. But it's very bright pink. It comes up, flowers for many weeks. Really, really fun. That's Bilbergia. And let's see what else I have in my notes. Let's see. Now, of course, that tillandsia is an epiphytic. The one that we're looking at, tillandsia cyanea, is native to Ecuador, and is among the most commonly cultivated bromeliad species. The foliage grows in a rosette of thin recurved leaves, and the inflorescence is a plume of pink or red bracts from which violet flowers emerge. So that was the tillandsias that we're talking about. Now, Bilbergia, we looked at pyramidalis. That's what's up behind us right now. Bilbergias can also look a little different than that. Take a look at number 10. They don't need to be quite so tight, and they can be a little looser. Bring that up full screen. And you can see here are the individual flowers, not so tight, and here's the pink. Now, because this is pink, these leaves are not pink. And we'll look at some others that actually are just the opposite. One study found 175,000 bromeliads per hectare in the forest. That many bromeliads can sequester 50,000 liters of water. So it's a tremendous resource of water in a forest or in a rainforest. A wide variety of organisms take advantage of the pools of the water trapped by the bromeliads. There was a study in 2,209 plants from the Ecuadorian lowlands identified 11,219 animals representing more than 300 distinct species, found only on bromeliads. So this is bromeliads create a unique niche or habitat for very small organisms, aquatic organisms, to live in their cups. Some species of ostracoids are small salamanders, approximately 2.5 centimeters in length, and tree frogs, and even other species of bromeliads. So you can actually have bromeliads growing inside the cup of bromeliads. So Jamaican bromeliads are home to a crab called meadow Polyasis depressus, which is a reddish-brown crab about 2 centimeters across, about 3/4 of an inch, which has evolved social behavior to protect its young from predation from a damselfly whose larvae live in bromeliads. So you have a whole world inside that cup. You've got this crab, you've got a damselfly whose larvae are trying to eat the larvae of the crab. So you have a whole world inside there. So these, of course, bromeliads are widely represented in their natural climates across the Americas. There's only one species from Africa. They can be found at altitudes from sea level to 4,200 meters. Now, 4,200 meters, that's more than 10,000 feet. That's way up there. So from rainforest to deserts to the tops of mountains. About half of the species are epiphytic. Some are lithophytes and some are terrestrial. Accordingly, these plants can be found in the Andean highlands from northern Chile to Colombia, in the coasts of Peru and the cloud forests of Central and South America, and in southern Florida and Texas. And the bromeliad, there is a Bromeliad Society International, and you can find them on the internet quite easily. Now, just to talk a little bit more about bromeliads before I pull some out and talk a little bit more about them, let's go to a video clip. Bromeliad plant care, and this is nice. He talks about a number of species and he talks about the mix he uses. So let's go to bromeliad plant care and take a look at this video. And then when you come back, we'll talk about more about bromeliads and we'll see if someone can guess our mystery plant.
G'day, this is Bob from Paradise, and this is tip number 7 from your tip of the week. Today we're going to talk about bromeliads, and we've got a couple here behind you. This is a Guzmania, that one's in flower at the moment, and this one's a Varisia with an orange flower. We've got quite a few different types. This is actually a Tillandsia in behind us here. That's a much smaller type of bromeliad. They're a miniature. And all these bromeliads actually are epiphytes. They grow on trees or on rocks. So over here, we've got this one grows into quite a big one. It's an Echmia, and it's Echmia mexicana. Grows to about a meter high. So there are a lot of different types, a lot of different habits. And I was just going to show you how to pot up a bromeliad, and we might be able to divide one as well. If we just come down here. First of all, I'll show you, this is a giant bromeliad too, called Imperialis. We generally don't send them quite this big, they're about this high, but they're quite big plants. Something that people didn't realise with a lot of these giant bromeliads, that they have tiny little pups. Most of the broms grow pups that get bigger than the parent, and quickly so. These have little, what we call grass pups, and you can take them out quite easily. Even if there's no roots on them, you can propagate them if you put them into a coarse mix. So that's Imperialis, Alcantaria Imperialis, and another Alcantaria, which is another giant one, is this one right here. It's a beautiful brom, gets great big spray of flowers up high. That's called Alcantaria Regina Alba. It's a silver, there's a lot of silver tones into the foliage, so they get the alba out of that. And that's another one that has grass pups. Now if we just come down here, I'll just show you the type of mix that we use to put bromeliads into. Basically we use two types of mixes in our nursery. Our normal mix, which has got, it's composted radiata pine bark, or most of the country it is, but this is from the southern pine plantations. They're hybrids, Pinus elliottii, that sort of pine tree. The bark is composted, and see how most of this is pretty fine material, less than 10 millimeter diameter, but we get 20% added into it of coarse material, like this one, 15 millimeters. So when we say millimeters, we mean the distance of the particles. See how wide it is? That's 1.5 centimeters across. About 2/3 of an inch, if you're in the old scale. And all this other stuff we call fines, and there's all different particle sizes in there. It's graded right out to just what you want. And what we do, this has already got 20% in it, of coarse material, but bromeliads like it much coarser. So with a bromeliad, we'll add 40% of more of this 15 millimeter bark. See how coarse it is? Really coarse. And that's what they've got to have. A lot of bromeliads, you'll kill them if you pot them up into anything finer. Of course, you might have been getting away with just using a normal potting mix with some, and that'll be quite all right for those plants. But then suddenly you'll get some different ones, and they'll have a different requirement altogether, and they'll be stone dead when you get a wet period. So we're just going to look at a couple more here. This is one of my favourites. Unfortunately, the flowers are up the other end, but this, we've had this in our catalogue recently. It's called Echmia fasciata. It's been in our catalogue. It's got a beautiful pink flower about that size, and lasts for months and months and months. And you can grow that on a tree, right? You can grow all the broms on a tree, or you can grow them in the coarse mix in the ground. And just telling you about the potting up mendigo, if you're planting it in the ground, I'd use this coarse mix, dig a hole but make sure it can't fill with water, and plant it into this sort of material. And we'll be talking to you more about this coarse material for tropical plants, because it's not well known that you should have coarse mixes for most of your tropical plants, so they make it through the winter period when it's wet, so they're still well drained. This is another one. Yeah, we haven't started selling this one yet. And that's called Gusmania. I have to look at the label. Magnifica. Gusmania Magnifica. It's I think that's an orange flower that's sort of in around about this height here. So that's another really nice brom. And over here we've just potted up these tiny little fellas into a fairly coarse mix, just as I described it to you, and that's a pineapple, which is the Ananas type, Ananas bracteata, but it's a variegated one. It's a variegated ornamental pineapple. Now, we've just potted them up. If we get a really wet period now, we'll probably lose the whole lot. So we've just got to watch the weather. We might move them undercover. We don't want them getting too wet when we've just potted them up. You can lose young plants that way. So put that one there. And I think we've just about, here's another one over here. This gets a red flower, comes right up high. And you can just see all the stripes in there. It's called a striped torch. And it gets a big torch flower. And it's Gusmania monostachya. Yeah, it's a very, very attractive. We're still selling that one, but we've only got about a dozen plants left. So that's the end of our discussion for today. If you've got any questions, just give us a phone call. And we'll catch you next time. Just don't forget that our website's www.paraplants.com, and it's been...
So, the one thing that I kind of took from that video is that you don't want to use standard potting mix when you're potting up your pups or repotting your bromeliads. You want to use a very coarse mix. So the best thing would be to take your potting mix and maybe mix it 50-50 with a medium orchid bark. That would be excellent. Or maybe just perlite, which might be a little cheaper. But if you've got, in fact, I would think all these bromeliads would really do quite well in just a cymbidium mix or a straight orchid bark mix. But you could mix in a little bit of potting soil, and they would do quite well. So now the other one genus I want to talk about a little bit is Neorigelia. And this is one of them. This is different from the others in that it doesn't send up a tall spike. The flowers are down inside the cup. Now, if we take a close-up look at this particular plant, you can see down in here in the plant, this one is already bloomed. And you can see that the leaves themselves have turned red, and the flowers were way down in here. You didn't get a big, long spike. Now this plant is shot and it's dying away. And what's happened now is it's growing two new plants on the side. Now in order to repot these, now you can let them just grow like this, but they tend to be, in my experience, a little smaller than if you cut them off and pot them separately. So you want to reach down with your shears and cut them off as close to the stem as possible. So this one, I'm just going to reach down and do that, and then I'll show you. I got to reach in there and get it. It's a little woody. Now, if I can get some roots with it, that'll be even better. And it's got its own roots, so let me pull off some of the roots. There we go. Now, here is my new plant. And now, these don't color up real good if you grow them in deep shade. This is Neorigelia, and I've lost the... let's see, I could probably figure it out. Now, I have a little video clip on Neorigelia. Now, you can see, if I turn this, here's the cup. And this is a pup. This is a little plant that grew off the other plant. And it's got its own roots. So this, you just put it in a pot with a very coarse mix. And I usually take a rock or some broken pot, like a clay pot that's broken. I'll take little pieces of it and support it so it'll stay up straight. And then eventually it will grow lots of roots in the soil, and it'll hold itself up, and you can take those away. If you put this where it gets morning sun, it'll get a lot of color, a lot of red will develop in these white stripes. If you grow it in the deep shade, it's going to stay pretty green. It will color up real good once it starts to flower. So that's Neo-Regelia, and I'd like now, let's have a little video clip on Neo-Regelia. It's a really nice genus, and our next video clip, we'll talk about Neo-Regelia and show you some of the really nice varieties. There's quite a few different ones. Let's take a look at this clip.
Neo-Regelia, or Neo as they're called in short, is probably the largest group or genus of bromeliads. This one here is Neo Passion crossed with Grace. A nice pink color. Gets to about 18 inches wide. Hasn't quite come into bloom yet. Neos can be very small. This is Neo Dungziana. You can see my finger. It's only about 3 to 4 inches tall. And that's its maximum size. Or they can get quite large. This is Neo Johannes. And that leaf there is about 2 feet long. This will get to about 3 feet in width and get a nice red center once it comes into bloom. Other Neos are spotted like this. It's called Neo Spotted Knight. Gets to about 12 inches tall by 12 inches wide. Neo McWilliamsii is a popular one. This one here is shade grown, so it's quite large. Get to about 2 to 3 feet wide. They're stoloniferous, meaning they send out pups on a small arm, and they get a red center as they come into bloom. This is Neo McWilliams. Very few Neos can take full sun. This one can. This is called Neo Petra. It's described as a coral pink. It's a nice pink color. These get to about 18 inches wide by about 6 inches tall. Great for landscaping. Neo Petra. Takes full sun. Don't want to put it in full shade, it'll lose its color, but a half day sun or filtered sun will work too. Neos are not known for producing much of a showy bloom. This is a Neo Chlorostricta. It's getting a little bit too much sun. You can see a little bit of sunburn here. It's in about 50% shade cloth. And in the middle here, you can see where the bloom has already come up and died about a month ago. And now you just have little brown flower buds left over. So they don't have a bloom that comes up like Acmeas and Hohenbergias and other bromeliads. The bloom stays in the middle. They get purple flowers and it lasts about 6 to 8 weeks. This here is a Grant Groves hybrid called Neo Pink Debbie. It's a nice pink coloration on it. It's getting a little bit too much sun here. Gets to about 12 inches tall by 8 inches wide. Over here we have Neo Fire on Deck, another popular one for collectors here in Florida. And because there's been so many hybrids of Neos over the years, a lot of them come into our nursery unnamed, such as this one. It has spots all over, it's purple, gets quite large, about 2 feet wide by a foot tall, and we've called this one Neo Giant Galaxy. Nice color. Most Neos produce quite a few offsets or pups. This is a Neo Fingernails. It's already bloomed. You can see the center leaves have died, but it has two pups, one on either side. This one takes full sun, no problem, and is very cold tolerant. And within certain Neos, you have cultivars, which is a subspecies. This is Neo Carcharodon, also known as Neo Tiger. However, this one doesn't have any tiger striping on it. But this is Neo Carcharodon Yang, and it has nice pink variegation down the middle. This one's growing in quite a bit of shade, and it's actually mounted up on a log, as you can see, with some vine growing around it. And a popular thing that we do here in Florida on our landscapes is use Neos as ground cover. You can simply clump them all together, combine a couple of crotons. These are all in quite heavy shade. But you mix variegated ones with colorful ones and just let them all grow together. Gives you a very natural look and natural effect. And they essentially just live off of rainwater. These don't receive any irrigation here. Here you can see Neo Petra, one of the ones that we looked at before. not quite as bright as the ones in sun, and that one's actually coming into bloom. You can see the small flower coming up from the center. Neos can also grow on trees. There's a couple neos growing on a cygra species, just tucked into the bark. Here are some neos that have some striping on them, like this one. This is a poblito. And back here is a treasure chest. And they look great, clumped together, good alternative to lawn and other bushes and plants, lots of color, low maintenance. Neorigilla.
Well, I was just looking up a little more to try and identify my plants I brought in. That one with the tall blue spike is actually an acmea. So it can fool you. If you lose your tags, it can be difficult to remember what your plants actually are. But if you have some bromeliads and you want to identify them, you would maybe take them down to the Rainforest Flora and Botanic Garden, and I'm sure they'll be happy to tell you what you got. And then, of course, you'll probably won't be able to resist purchasing a couple more. Let's talk about a little bit about Spanish moss, because Spanish moss is really a very interesting plant. It grows in the humid southern locales from Georgia, Louisiana, Mississippi, Florida, eastern North Carolina, southeast Virginia, South Carolina, Texas, and Alabama. And it is associated with a southern Gothic imagery. In the southern United States, there is a tale that is told about Spanish moss, and I'll read you this paragraph. There was once a traveler who came with his Spanish fiancée in the 1700s to start a plantation near the city of Charleston, South Carolina. She was a beautiful bride-to-be with long flowing hair. As the couple was walking over the plantation near the forest and making plans for their future, they were suddenly attacked by a band of Cherokee who were not happy to share the land with strangers. As a final warning to stay away from the Cherokee Nation, they cut off the long dark hair of the bride-to-be and threw it up in an old live oak tree. As the people came back day after day and week after week, they began to notice the hair had shriveled and turned gray and began spreading from tree to tree. Over the years, the moss spread from South Carolina to Georgia and Florida. To this day, if one stands under a live oak tree, one will see the moss jump from tree to tree and defend itself with a large army of beetles. So, of course, that's probably not true that Tillandsias or Spanish moss originated as hair from a beautiful woman, but it's a nice story. At one time, some 5,000 tons of Spanish moss were harvested and used in the U.S. alone. The moss is sometimes bought for use in arts and crafts or for bedding for flower gardens, and it was once used to stuff mattresses. Probably not the best thing to do if you want to keep a species healthy and going well in the forest. That's the kind of thing that might actually strip it out, and you might end up with no Spanish moss. But that's not actually happening. Spanish moss is doing quite well throughout the area. Now, you can also grow bromeliads directly in your garden. You don't have to grow them in pots. You can tie them on trees and stuff. And I have a little video clip that shows people growing them on trees. So let's take a look at how to grow bromeliads in the landscape. This is the fourth on our list. So if we can take a look at how to grow bromeliads in the landscape, in this clip, you'll see how he's tied them on or attached them to a trunk of a tree. And just by spritzing them on a regular basis, they've become a huge mass. And you can do that quite easily with bromeliads. So let's take a look at that. If you have a dead tree in your yard and you don't want to cut it down, and it's not going to fall down and hurt anybody or smash your house, you can actually retain it. Yeah, in fact, you can do it on a live tree for that matter too. But a dead tree leaves some of the problems I have with growing things on the trunks of trees. Let's take a look at this video clip.
Hi, this is Robert from Robert's Tropical Paradise Garden. Today we're going to talk about the wonderful world of bromeliads, and they're really a spectacular plant. There's over 3,000 different types. This is a terrestrial type, meaning it's growing in the ground, and it's a very large one as well, with brilliant yellowy, orangey color, and it gets a big, big, big flower spike. So the left over there is another gorgeous one that's just blooming right now, with a greenish, grayish color leaves and a orangey yellow flower spike. Over here, this bromeliad is considered an epiphytic bromeliad. Epiphytes are plants that don't grow in the soil. I stuck just a few of these on the tree with liquid nails several years ago, and now it's taking over the whole trunk and it really looks beautiful. Here's some of the blooms as well. Now, in the bromeliad family is also the amazing pineapple, tillandsia, and many others. Spanish moss, they're all part of the bromeliad family. I'm going to show you around the garden to show you some others as well. This is the same bromeliad I had in the front of the house. This is on the side. And as you can see, there's a huge flower spike I was telling you about. And over here, I have a whole bunch of bromeliads growing as a ground cover. This is actually the top of a pineapple, and in 2 years, we'll be getting a fresh pineapple. They grow right from the center. This particular bromeliad is grown for its magnificent colorations of the foliage. These potted bromeliads are called cryptanthus. They do well in these clay pots. Here the bromeliads are used as a border for my bonsai pavilion area in the garden.
So attaching them to trees is a really wonderful way to grow them. You just got to make sure you put them on a tree that's not going to get afternoon full sun on the trunk. I see we have a phone call. Let's go to our caller. Who do we have on the phone today? Terry calling from South Pasadena. You're on the air.
I have a friend who lives in the mountains, and she has mistletoe growing in the top of her tree. And I was wondering, how bad is that for the trees, and how do I get rid of it?
Okay, well, that's a good question. Mistletoe is fairly common in a lot of tree species. And you said you saw it at the top of the tree?
Yes, the top.
Well, that's an interesting observation that if you go around, you'll notice that almost all the mistletoe you see in trees is at the very top of the tree. And there's a very good reason for that, is that mistletoes are predominantly spread by birds. And they often they eat the fruit, or you know, the little berries, or they get the seeds on their bills or on their feet. And birds tend to perch at the tops of trees. They don't like to be down at the bottom of the tree very much. That's not the best place to be if you're a bird and something's trying to catch you. They like to be at the top of the tree. It gives them a bird's eye view of the area they're in. So often what you'll see is that the mistletoes are always at the very top of the tree, which can be very difficult to get to. Now, most mistletoes are fairly benign and don't do a lot of damage to the tree. Now, if you get very heavy infestation, it may not be the best thing for the tree, and you might want to try and remove it. And you need to remove the branch that's infected. If you just cut off the mistletoe itself and leave where it's attached, it will grow right back, because mistletoe make what are called haustoria. Now, that's a general term that a lot of organisms that are parasitic on other plants, like fungi, and in this case, mistletoe, they grow into the branch and they form a union between their membrane and the plant membranes in the cells. And that is called a haustoria. And that's still in the branch if you don't cut out the branch. So you have to remove the branch. But the problem is it's at the top of the tree. So you would have to hire a tree service to go up there and remove any infected branches if you want to get rid of the mistletoe. But there are there's many different species of mistletoe. There's not just one, there's many different kinds. And there is a group of mistletoes called dwarf mistletoe. Now, dwarf mistletoes are particularly bad for trees. They are systemic in that they can be fruiting off the trunk and then grow up through the vascular tissue of the plant and poke out 20 feet up. And so you'll often end up with a whole bunch of these very short, stubby inflorescences. Really, it's just the flower that comes out of the trunk on the dwarf mistletoes. And if they get on a tree when they're young, they'll stunt it severely. In fact, dwarf mistletoe was a severe problem in maintaining forests. And the Forest Service tried for some time to try and limit the spread of dwarf mistletoe in the forest by cutting down a large swath of trees around an infested area. Now, on dwarf mistletoes, they can actually shoot their seeds a great distance, like 20, 30, 40 feet. And the little berries build up pressure, and then they explode, and the sticky little seed goes flying through the air and will hit the trunk and stick to the trunk and then germinate and then grow in the tree. So the Forest Service tried to cut down these wide swaths, about 100 feet wide, surrounding areas with dwarf mistletoe. But now, if it's at the top of the tree growing off a branch, it's not the dwarf mistletoe. It's important to control dwarf mistletoe if you get it. If you live up in the mountains or in the foothills and you have dwarf mistletoe on a tree, you should remove any infected parts or remove the whole tree, usually, because it will really devastate the tree over time. But for these other species of mistletoe that occur at the very tops of the trees, you can just hope that some of it breaks off right around Christmas, and then you can hang it in your home as a Christmas decoration and a way to attract the opposite sex if you stand under it.
Okay.
Of course, you're supposed to use it to solicit affection that way. But in general, the mistletoes are not particularly harmful to their hosts. Most of them are photosynthetic. That means they're green. They're making their own food. The only thing they're getting from their host is water and nutrients. But a very heavy infestation you should probably address, because it can weaken the branches, and you might have branches break and fall out of the canopy. So the other question would be, well, is the tree off by itself, where if a branch falls, it's not going to hurt anything? Then you could just live with it, especially if you live up in the mountains and you don't really have an area. I mean, you might have basically a part of the forest is what your home, and you don't really have a lot of people out in that area, so you could just ignore it. Now, if it's right next to your house and people walk under it a lot and there's a lot of mistletoe, then you probably might want to address that.
Okay. Okay, well, thank you for all that information. I'm going to tell my friend about it.
Okay. Thank you for your call, and thank you for watching the show. Now, I just want to mention something else about mistletoe, since the subject's come up. Some research has indicated that mistletoes are actually beneficial to the whole population of its host, because the birds often, some of our native birds actually depend on some of that mistletoe fruit, the little seed pods, for their winter food. It may not be their sole source of food, but it could be a substantial portion, especially at different times of the year. And they are attracted to trees with the mistletoe. And they also feed on the fruit of the tree. So in some stands of native plants in California, if you have mistletoe growing on them, you actually have a higher recruitment rate, which means you get more seedlings and more new plants if you have mistletoe than if you in stands where there's no mistletoe, because the mistletoe actually attracts the birds to the plants, which then disseminate the seeds of the tree as well. So on a population level, mistletoe can be a mutualistic a symbiont, which means that the mistletoe benefits, it gets water and nutrients off its host, and the entire population of trees benefit because they get more birds coming and disseminate more of their seeds. Now, if you just look at one plant, you may not see that, but often when you're talking about a native plant with a naturally occurring native parasitic plant, you need to look at the population to see the effect on the whole population, not just on one individual plant. Because certainly in some cases, a very heavy infestation of mistletoe can be detrimental. The other thing to note is that often mistletoe doesn't get on the young plants because they like to land on the tall plants, the older trees. So typically a lot of these trees that get mistletoe may be very old already, and it's hard to say that the mistletoe is hurting the tree. The tree may be very old anyway. And so just because it has mistletoe doesn't mean the mistletoe is hurting it. If a tree is already reaching 100 years old or 200 years old, and it's a tree that's its, roughly its lifespan or its functional lifespan, then the mistletoe is getting on it because it was the tallest tree, it was the oldest tree, and the birds, that's what the birds like to land on. So it's important to keep those things in mind, that the mistletoe is not necessarily really harmful on a population basis. And even on an individual tree, unless you get a heavy infestation, it's not normally going to be a big problem. But we're talking about bromeliads and tillandsias, and I just want to talk a little bit about tillandsias more. This is a little piece of driftwood that my son purchased for me as a gift. You know, he knows whenever my birthday or Christmas comes around, I prefer plants. And so that's what he always gets me. And he got me this one several years ago, and it was in a pot, of course. Well, eventually the pot just, this thing just kind of fell out of the pot. It was just sticking in the pot like this. And so I pulled it out, and now I have it leaning against a little wall in my front yard. And whenever the sprinklers go on, it gets spritzed. And sometimes if I'm watering pots, I'll spray it. But now some of these older leaves, this is always an opportunity for me to clean my plants when I have my program. Now this one, I don't believe is flowered for me. So this is something that you can do with any of your plants when they get a lot of old leaves, is just pluck them off because it looks a little ratty with that. Now this is stuck in kind of the corner of my yard, and I rarely actually get a chance to work on it. But there, that kind of cleaned that up. That looks so much nicer. And here's some sphagnum moss, and this is wired on, and then this is growing in the little bit of sphagnum moss. But the top one, these are two different, this is two different species of tillandsias. And of course, when he bought it, it didn't come with the name. But over here, now this top one is getting to be a real clump, you can see. And you can see where it's bloomed here, and it's bloomed, where else are the blooms? Here's an old bloom. But if we look really closely, it still has the color. This bloom is actually not even all that done. And again, it's got a little bit of some dead leaves on it, which I could pluck off. All you have to do with these tillandsias is spritz them. You might put a little tiny bit of fertilizer in it, maybe about 10% or 25% of the recommended rate, but just very little bit. Now here you can see the flowers. So when this blooms, it's really, really kind of fun. It's a small flower. It's not real showy. It's not going to knock your socks off when you see it, but it's real fun to see them bloom. And I've watched this bloom repeatedly, and the clump gets bigger and bigger and bigger. And a lot of times people will hang their bromeliads, maybe just on a little, I mean their tillandsias, just on like a wire cage. You know, the way I grow this Spanish moss is just like this. I have a little piece of wire, I have this attached to a hook, and that's how I grow my Spanish moss. And then I just hose that down or spritz it. You know, if I could do it every day, that would be better, but I usually don't get to it that often. So that's, those are the tillandsias. They're really fun. Now let's talk a little bit about our mystery plant and talk about some of the problems it's having, because I have a number of these plants. Oh, I see we have another phone caller. Let's go to our next caller while I clean my hands off. Carol, calling from Canoga Park. You're on the air.
Hi. Can you give me any help with nut grass in my flower beds?
Well, you've picked one of the most difficult weeds to control, or it's picked you, I guess.
Yeah.
There is a product called Sedge Hammer.
Yes.
And that is, it used to be called, I'm trying to think what the old name was. I think the new name is Sedge Hammer. And that, you have to apply it repeatedly. The problem with nut grass is it makes little bulbs on its roots. And if you just pull out the plant, you'll leave behind these little bulbs or those little nuts. And they'll germinate, and you pull out one plant and five more come up. So you have to, a friend of mine had it in his garden. He told me it took him a year to get rid of it with repeat applications of Sedge Hammer and also weeding. Now, is this a planter, you said?
Well, I've got them in flower beds, yeah. I've used it on the lawn, you know, in a general spray, but then in the flower beds, I can't spray without getting the plants.
Yeah. What kind of plants do you have growing in the flower bed?
Mostly perennials.
Well, what I do, I've got it in my backyard. I've got purple nut sedge in my backyard. And whenever it comes up, I dig it up with a big shovel, a regular shovel, and I get a big clump of dirt this big. And I take that and I put it, the whole thing, in the trash. Because otherwise, it's just going to keep coming back up. So, and then if you want to use that sedge hammer, you could use it in a little mister bottle. And as soon as you get the smallest little shoot coming up, you've got to hit it. It's really a challenge. It's one of the most difficult of all the weeds to eradicate and control. The other option is to try and use what I've mentioned in previous shows, is to cover it with cardboard and then cover that with 2 to 4 inches of some type of organic compost or mulch. And that will actually suppress it pretty effectively. But it's such a tough plant. You might have to keep that, you know. So what you do is go into your flower bed and take cardboard and lay it on the surface of the soil. You might have to cut it up into small pieces so you can fit it in around the plants. And then bury that and overlap it, and then bury that with compost. That would be the organic way to try and do it. The other way, the conventional way, would be to spray it with the sedge hammer.
Okay, that sounds great. Now, could I ask you a question about watering as well?
Oh, yes, go right ahead.
This may sound like a dumb question, but I've heard you say in past shows, like, for instance, 1 inch of water during certain parts of the year. So if I have a basin built around a plant and I put a hose in and, say, within half a minute, it's filled up with 1 inch of water, is that giving it 1 inch of water?
Well, when you do basins, what I generally do is I usually fill them up at least 3 times because I want to get that to soak. You know, if you have a small tree or a fruit tree or something like that, and you're trying to soak the soil to a depth of 2 to 3 feet. So you fill up that basin and it soaks in. And then you can either take a rod and shove it in the ground and see how deep the water went. The rod will go as deep as the water went, and when it hits dry soil, it'll be very difficult to push it any farther, if not impossible. So what I would do is fill up the basin and then test how deep the water went. And usually it's going to take 2 or 3 times you got to fill up that basin. You would think that maybe that 1 inch would correlate, but I'll tell you, it takes 3 to 4 inches of water to soak the soil to a depth of about 2 to 3 feet.
Okay, that answers my question.
So, but that kind of varies. If you have a sandy soil, it'll go a little deeper. If you have a heavy clay, you need the full 4 inches. And generally, what I recommend is for perennials, that you, every time you water, you put down about 3 inches of water. And every time you water a lawn, you put down about 1/2 inch of water. Perennials are watered about once a month, every 2 weeks, depending on the season and the particular species. Like if junipers, you could water them once a month, kind of year-round. But roses, I'd probably water them about every 2 weeks in the spring and the fall and once a week in the summer. But every time I do it, I try and really soak them a good 2 feet. So you have to kind of adjust to what you're watering in the season.
Now, at your suggestion, I went to the Thomas Paine Foundation and got some yarrow and some penstemon. Now, those being native plants, do they need to be watered any differently?
Well, they're very drought tolerant, both of those to the large extent. The yarrow, I would probably water that yarrow about maybe in August and September. I might even water it once a week just to keep it fresh and green. A lot of our California natives kind of go dormant in the summer if you go let them dry, and then they don't look so good. So I think for the penstemon, you could get away with every 2 weeks, even in once a month in the spring and the fall and 2 weeks in the summer. But if you see it not doing well, I would step it up to once a week. And then a lot of those penstemons tend to fall over. When they start to get real tall, when they bloom and they get real tall flowers, they have a tendency to lodge or fall over. So you typically need some stakes and some twine or something to hold them up. And then at the end of the year, you can prune them back quite a bit, and they'll come back real strong.
Right. Okay, thank you for the information.
And thanks for the call, and thanks for watching the show. And it's fun that you went to Payne, the Thomas Paine Foundation, which, of course, is in Sunland, Their nursery's in Sunland, and they specialize in California natives. And I was just thinking about this the other day, about growing California natives. And of course, there are many plants that grow in California that grow in very wet areas, or very wet niche or climate, especially like the redwood tree grows up in Northern California, where there's two different species of redwood. There's the coast redwood, and then the other ones that grow in the Southern Sierra. And I forget the specific common name for it. It's a redwood tree as well. But, you know, the coastal redwood, which grows all along the border with Oregon and up in Northern California, I find that it's not a particularly good species for Southern California, even though it's native to California. It's really not native to Southern California. So if you do want to grow natives in your garden here in Southern California, you should concentrate on those plants that really are well adapted to hot, dry conditions. Not because if you go up into some of our mountain streams and canyons and go to a waterfall or go along the stream, you'll find California natives that grow right along those streams. So there's ferns, there's some trees, like the California sycamore or the western sycamore, or the white alder, which grows all the way from, you know, British Columbia to Southern California. But they grow right in the stream. Now, the sycamores do quite well whether they're in the stream or not in the stream, really. They are wonderful tree species for Southern California. But the alders, they like to be right in the river, and they tend to be short-lived species in Southern California. So you get about 30 years maybe out of an alder, and then it starts to decline. They do pretty well on a lawn because they get watered frequently in the lawn. But they actually do their best if they're growing right in a moving stream. And there's a big difference between a moving stream and a pond that's not moving, because the difference in oxygen in the water is tremendous. So moving water is really what we're talking about, not a lakeside or a pond. But they also are ferns. I've hiked frequently up in Eaton Canyon and up in Schweitzer Schweitzer campground off the Angeles Crest Highway. And if you're hiking along, and you'll see on the shady wet spots, there'll be little springs, you know, little places where water weeps out of the side of the slope, and there'll be ferns growing there. Those are native ferns to California. They are very, very water. They need a lot of water. So, you know, Penstemon's wonderful. It's been highly hybridized. It's called Beard's Tongue, I believe is the common name. And there's all sorts of different colors of Penstemon. I've grown it on and off over the years, and I find that sometimes have trouble keeping it going. But that may be because they're getting a little root rot, and a lot of the California natives are highly susceptible to root rot. But let's talk about our mystery plant, because we're getting later in the show. This is a rhododendron. This is a standard rhododendron. And I'm going to tip it over and show you the bloom again. There's the bloom. So rhododendrons, the genus itself is native to every continent in the world. So you find them from all over the world. Are the ones that we grow from the Pacific Northwest. This is that type. There's many different, the genus could probably be broken up into different genera. Now this particular one is called Angel's Crest, and it's probably a hybrid. But there's a couple things that we want to look at that's going on with it. One is it's chlorotic. The leaves are a little yellow. The veins are staying green, but interveinal, it's yellowing. That's because these are what we refer to as being acid-loving plants. And let me see if I can just tip that a little bit. You can see that flower again. Anyway, if we could come and look at this leaf right here. Now, why are plants acid-loving? They don't really love anything that's, you know, giving them human characteristics. What they really need is an acid soil. And the reason they need an acid soil is for iron availability. You can see how yellow these leaves have become. You can also see some burning on the tips and the burning on these leaves. So that's not good, you know, and there's two things going on. One is that it's iron deficient, almost certainly iron deficient. The new growth is coming out yellow. And so if it were a nitrogen deficiency, the new growth may still be green because nitrogen is mobile in the plant. In fact, this one on this side shows it really nicely. The old growth on this is really, really dark green, really nice. This is, you can see these leaves here in the back. This is one of my hands on. That's nice and green. And the new growth that's coming out, these leaves, and here's the spring flush here. These leaves are quite yellow. Well, if this were a nitrogen deficiency, then the old leaves would lose their nitrogen and it would be moved to the new growth. And the old leaves would turn yellow and the new growth would be green. And then you'd say, oh, that's definitely nitrogen deficiency. Now in this case, the new leaves are yellow and the old leaves are green. That really indicates an iron deficiency. So, and this is why what we call acid-loving plants need acid soils, because iron solubility is governed by the soil pH. So if you are at pH 8, there's very little dissolved iron available. All the iron precipitates out as an oxide in the soil. Soil chemistry gets a little complicated, and I'll try not to make it too complicated because it'll just confuse myself too. But when you have a high pH, the iron precipitates. As you lower the pH, if you go from 8 to 7, you increase the solubility of iron tenfold. If you go from 7 to 6, you increase the solubility another tenfold. From 8 to 6, it's a 100-fold increase in iron solubility. And a lot of the plants we grow are very, very dependent on being in an acid soil. Our soils are naturally calcareous, which means they're typically high calcium levels, and they're typically alkaline, often around 8. And our water is often alkaline too, often about 7.5 to 8. So we are trying to grow acid-loving plants in an alkaline environment. So what do you do with these rhododendrons, azaleas, camellias, gardenias, and blueberries? All of these are what we call acid-loving plants. They need a soil that is acid in order to acquire enough iron. Otherwise, they turn yellow. So you grow them in peat moss. Peat moss is very acid. You can apply chemicals to them to keep the soil acidic. On these blueberries, the new hot thing are these low-chill blueberries. They're wonderful. There's a whole bunch of different cultivated varieties of low-chill blueberries that'll give you good fruit, here, even in warm winters in Southern California, because the standard blueberries need, you know, vernalization or chill in order to flower and produce fruit. So now we have low-chill blueberries that you can grow in warm areas, but they need a lot of acid in the soil. You know, they need, so people put either vinegar on them directly. Vinegar is acetic acid, and if you dilute it and apply it as a root drench, it works pretty well to keep the soil acid. Or you can use iron, ferrous sulfate. Iron sulfate is a yellow powder, and the iron, of course, will elevate the iron availability in the soil directly, and the sulfate is acidifying. So on azaleas, they often turn yellow, and once they turn yellow, they won't do anything until you get that iron problem fixed. And so this has an iron problem. And I think the other problem, and I'll just pluck off a leaf and I'll show you this. Let's take a look at this leaf on the overhead. This is typical salt burn symptom. So I think two things are going on with this rhododendron. One is in the pot, the dissolved solids from our water has elevated the salt content of that pot. So that plant badly needs to be repotted, and I'm going to repot it in about a 50% peat moss and 50% perlite or vermiculite mix. But this type of leaf burn, the tip of the leaf has turned brown. This is typical of salt burn. So this can happen either from using a lot of fertilizers or just from our water, because we have a lot of our water is very hard, which means there's a lot of dissolved solids in the water. Very high in calcium carbonates, calcium salts, and magnesium salts. So if you take a glass of water and you let it evaporate away, and you have all this white stuff left over after the water evaporates, then, you know, that's the salts that's in the water. Well, as you keep watering the pot, this little 1 gallon pot, and then the water goes in with all the salts, and then it either goes through the plant or evaporates out, and you keep watering it and keep watering it, and slowly that pot becomes very, very solidified, or it has a lot of dissolved solids in it. So, and this is the typical symptom you get. You get this tip burn from, and you see this on avocado very commonly in the end of the summer or going into the summer. The tips of avocados will become brown because they're very sensitive to salts. So what this plant needs, it needs to be repotted and heavily leached. And I'm going to put it in a little bigger pot because it's a really big pot, a big plant in a small pot, which is not a good way to grow plants in the first place. But I'll put it in a mix of peat moss. I like a coarse peat moss, not the real fine peat moss. And you have to kind of look for that coarse peat moss. It's real thick and coarse. It's not powdery and fluffy. And then I'll mix that with a little perlite. I could grow it in pure peat, actually, but pure peat has another problem, and that's if it goes dry, it's very hard to re-wet. So when I grow camellias, when I plant camellias or azaleas, now azaleas are rhododendrons, and I want to put this here so I remember to tell you something else, but for my azaleas, for a rhododendron, now these are difficult to grow in Southern California to a large extent. They don't like our hard water. They don't like our soil. They don't like the heat of the summer. So all those things are against you from the very beginning. We're trying, you know, if I try and grow this plant, I'm trying to grow a plant out of its natural habitat and out of its comfort zone for a large extent. So I need to grow it in a pot with lots of peat moss. I need to repot it fairly quick, commonly or frequently, I should say, about every 2 to 3 years, because that peat moss is going to decompose and lose some of the beneficial properties it has after about a year or two. I'm going to have to grow it in just the right spot where it'll get morning sun and be protected from the heat of the afternoon, because it doesn't like those hot, dry August, September days, especially in full sun. It would really be hard on it. So if you go up to the Pacific Northwest, or if you go to Europe and you see some of the rhododendrons you see across Europe, they're spectacular. But what do they get up in the Pacific Northwest? They get lots of rain, so they get lots of water that's coming with, you know, that's really very pure water, very, very low in dissolved solids. It's like the San Francisco Bay Area gets their drinking water, their tap water is soft water. So they, you know, when you turn on your hose up there and water your rhododendrons, you're not salting them. Down here, we're salting them a little bit. And in fact, soil salinification is a major problem in California and in anywhere where you irrigate your crops, because you're taking water, you put it on the ground, it soaks in, and then the water leaves, but the salts stay behind. Over time, the fields become saline, and then they can get a second problem if they get a lot of sodium in the soil, then they become sodic saline, and that's really disastrous soils for plants. There's very few plants that can grow in a really saline soil. One of them is asparagus. Asparagus is extremely salt tolerant. And in fact, asparagus used to, when you commercial production of asparagus, they used to use rock salt as an herbicide to kill all the weeds around the asparagus, because the asparagus didn't mind the rock salt, the salty soils, but it would kill the weeds. So that shows you how tough asparagus is. So you could grow asparagus in some of these saline soils if the environment is conducive for that too, in addition. So this is rhododendron. This is a standard rhododendron. Now the Malaysian rhododendrons are tropical. They're also called vireas, virea rhododendrons or Malaysian rhododendrons. And they repeat bloom. That's one of the nice things. You know, this will only really bloom once this spring, and then it's not going to bloom again for a year. The Malaysian rhododendrons are tropical, they're tender, they'll freeze. If we get a real cold snap, get down into the mid-20s or lower, you can kill them. So you got to be planted in a protected spot. And again, just like the normal rhododendrons or our native rhododendrons to the Pacific Northwest, they don't like the afternoon blast of heat, so you're going to need to be shaded in the afternoon. In order to get them bloom, they need bright light. So you need morning, you know, bright light, and then afternoon shade. They're going to want to be in an acid mix. And so if you put them in the ground and you can mix in a bunch of peat moss into your soil and it'll be acid for about a year or two. But then you're going to need to use acidifying fertilizers or use something like ferrous sulfate or even vinegar. And that would be periodically. And if you're growing blueberries, I know the people growing blueberries are putting the vinegar down either once a month or every other month. And it's a challenge to keep your blueberries with green, healthy foliage. Otherwise, it becomes a real problem. Now, let's see if there's anything additional in my notes for today. I just want to show you, this is Acmea fasciata, which is one of the more popular of all the bromeliads grown. And you can see that the flower is done. Let's go to the top, just to go back to our subject today, bromeliads. And here, I'll just tip this, and you can see the flower is shot. It's done. And I can just pull that out. It's all rotted, and it's shot. So we'll put it in my pile of garbage. And this plant is actually pretty much shot, too. It's not going to bloom again. It's going to just wither away and die. And a lot of the leaves are turning brown. But if you look on the side of it, let's go to the side cam over here, and we can get a good look at this. And you can see all the new plants coming up. This is a new plant right here. This is a new plant, just like on that Neo Regilia. And then here is the plant tag. What do you know? I still have the plant tag. Acmea primera. So it's a named cultivar, but of course fasciata is the species. And it says it's got a plant patent. So I guess I'm not supposed to take these pups and sell them, but I don't sell plants anyway. But so you can see these pups that are growing. There's 1, 2, 3, 4. How many are there really? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. There's 5 plants coming off this one plant in the middle. And I got to tell you, I got this plant after it was shot. It didn't sell at the nursery. The flower was done. The nursery wasn't going to sell it. I paid $1 for this. So for $1, I got 5 bromeliads. And all I have to do is cut them off and pot them up and give them a little bit of fertilizer. So this is our last show of the semester, and we'll be back in the fall. I don't know offhand. It's actually in my calendar, but I don't recall the first day, the first broadcast. It'll be in September. Oh, it's August 25th is when we'll be back on the air. If for some reason, and I'm just trying to clean all the debris off my notes before I put it away, if for some reason you have a question about your garden or a problem, you can contact me at the Los Angeles County Agricultural Commissioner's Office, where I am a senior biologist plant pathologist. And you can find our number just by Googling our department. And contacting our department, give us a call directly to the lab. Our services are free. So you can call me at the lab. You can email me digital photographs of your garden or your problem plant. I identify plants for people all the time. People send me pictures of their trees. They send me pictures of problems in their trees. They send me pictures of plants in their garden, and that is very, very helpful on diagnosing the actual problem. A lot of times if I get a sample, that's not quite enough. Well, our time is quickly coming to an end. I want to thank the crew and for their hard work all semester, taking care to get this program on the air. And I want to thank everyone who's called in. So until I see you in the fall, I want to wish you happy gardening and enjoy your gardens of California.